Welcome to Stand By Please.
With me, Antonia Collins from the Bamboo Manager Project.
And me, Jackie George from Sharjah Performing Arts Academy.
In this podcast, we talk all things stage management. Join us and our guests as we try to answer the question, what is your stage manager really thinking?
Hello and welcome to Stand By Please. In a slightly different episode than previously billed, today we bring you a special guest.
Do you know what? This week, I'm going to confess right at the beginning, I am a little bit starstruck.
What have you been up to?
No, I'm starstruck by who we have in the Zoom room today. And so I'm going to introduce you, Gail, before we go any further. But ladies and gentlemen, we have Gail Pallin with us here today.
I know. I think I probably know Gail a bit better than you then, Jackie, maybe, because Gail and I spent a semester together at the Royal Welsh College of Music and Drama many years ago when Gail's book,
Stage Management, The Essential Handbook.
Brilliant. And I think for many of our listeners, they now know immediately who we're talking to, because it's certainly one of probably the most recommended stage management books, I would say, across the world. It definitely featured on my reading list when I worked in America as well. It's generally accepted to be one of the most, if I say practical, I don't mean that to, that sounds slightly negative, but straightforward.
Yeah. Well, that was one of the reasons really for producing the book, writing the book in the first place, was when I came into teaching, there was nothing really new at that point. And also the ones that were there were a bit dense. And, you know, I was doing a lot of reading to make sure that I was kind of current practice, but a lot of the books were a lot older. And they were dense, there was kind of big chunks of paragraphs. Now, I don't know about you, but I was not particularly academic at school. So I thought, how can I make information that I've got to share with students more accessible? So I talked to them and I said, hey guys, what do you think? How can I write something that people will want to just have a quick dip into? That's why it's called the handbook, because it's about dipping into. I need to do a markup. There's a chapter on the markup. Here's lots of diagrams, lots of drawings, and some cartoons thrown in for good measure.
I was going to mention the cartoons.
Yes.
I mean, I feel like the cartoons almost have a life of their own.
They do.
Especially the one going on the tube.
Yes. That was me in London, trying to cope with propping in London, because, you know, Royal Court, no money. It was the 80s, everything on a shoestring. So, and the chap, my friend, who I was actually talking to last night, Mark, he worked at Derby Playhouse for years. That's where I met him. And he just has a really good kind of slightly lateral way of looking at theatre practice and the people who work in theatre. So they make me laugh anyway. So that's why I wanted to share it with the readers as well.
And I think that's why it works so well, because as stage managers, we look at those cartoons and we all relate to them instantly. And I remember a time actually getting on the tube at Vauxhall, had been to the National Theatre Stores. I had a roll of stage barbed wire around one arm and a statue of the Virgin Mary under the other. I got a seat. It was fantastic. Probably the only time I've got a seat at Vauxhall.
And it's still adding. So anytime there's a new edition, I generally sort of ask him to do another couple of cartoons. So we're lucky that he's still being creative in that way.
And it's certainly a book that I just use. I could probably quote book numbers for you on chapters and when I'm talking to students. And certainly when they say to me, if I was going to invest in one book, but to see me through the first sort of 6 months, what would you say? And it's instantly the first one that springs to mind.
How did you become a stage manager? Did you always want to be a stage manager?
My initial inspiration in terms of theatre going was Nutcracker. When I was a kid, I never liked panto. Panto scared me, because we're talking about the 60s and the 70s. Now, panto was a very different beast in those days. I'm not going to say too much more, but I'm sure people of my age will know what I mean. So didn't like panto, but mum and dad took me to Nutcracker, and oh, that just blew me away. It was just the most beautiful, inspiring thing I've seen. Then I saw Derek Jacobi doing his first, well, his second Hamlet. His first one, I believe, was when he was a school kid at the Edinburgh Festival. And again, I was just totally absorbed with the performance, but also how things worked and, oh, and that light, and I love that kind of big fan in the background. And how do they do that? It was the magic of it that drew me in. So I then joined a young farmers drama group. I did do a bit of performance, but I was always the one that wanted to get all the stuff and sort things. I wanted to organise when we got together and the schedule when we were there. And so I guess there was a wee stage manager just beginning to surface. Then I went off to drama school, again, did a bit of performance, but I really wanted to know how things worked and to be creative and to make that scene better. I was very lucky to be offered an equity card and an ASM stroke sound technician's job. The day I graduated, I just happened to get the bus back into Edinburgh. This is, you know, it's how it happens, isn't it? The networking and the being in the right place at the right time. Happened to be on the bus with the general manager of the Lyceum Theatre in Edinburgh. And he said, oh, we're looking for an ASM sound technician. Are you free? And I went, yes, actually, I think I, you know, looking through direct, yes, I'm free. So that was my first job and I was there a year. I spent 15 years in rep going ASM, DSM, stage manager, company stage manager, production manager, up and down the country, Royal Court, Haymarket Theatre, Leicester Derby Playhouse, One Theatre, Lyceum Edinburgh, Dundee Rep, Pitlochry Festival Theatre, the Bar Theatre. So my life was really in producing theatre. And I guess that's what I really, really loved and just being part of creating something, being part of that creative team. I did a bit of directing with youth and community, became a freelance, so much shorter jobs. So up until then, it had been kind of a year or 2 years in each place. But then I kind of settled down in the Fife area and started freelancing from there. And then I got into teaching at Queen Margaret University, lecturing. And the rest is history, really. Fife College after that. And now I'm kind of a freelance educator.
What are the big changes you've seen?
I think the getting work and the types of jobs that there are at the moment. When we first started, you were expected to stay in a producing theatre company for a good while. Whereas certainly the graduates from QM and Fife College more recently, much more short-term contracts, I think. I think the peripatetic nature of the job is very similar. You know, we do have to travel around. We do have to be willing to have a base, but then travel.
I think it's tougher.
The soft skills part of it, I feel, is watching and listening and absorbing and catching things out of the corner of your eye and spotting where somebody needs a hand or spotting that frown on an actor's face when they're looking at the props table going, I'm not sure what that is. And you go over and you say, can I help you? This is blah, blah, blah. You know, it's that ability to see what's going on behind you as well as in front of you. And both students and directors I've worked with alike have always said, you must have the best hearing in the world, because I can be chatting away to somebody here and I'm listening to the conversation back there, because that conversation back there, you know, 100 metres away from me is really important. And I need to convey that information to the people over there that are having another conversation over there. So it's that ability to be aware 360 degrees, isn't it, around about in your environment.
I was just going to jump in a second and say, I think the thing about the going to a theatre and working in a repertory company thing that was an advantage was that you got to do more than one show with the same team. Whereas now a lot of students will leave, they'll do one production and then they'll move on to another production, which is another new set of people, and another production that's another new set of people. Whereas by working in rep, you could kind of hone some of your skills. You could learn about people. You could have a go at something once and go, I'm never going to do that again and do it again. I just feel like it was a possibly more generous way of learning. Do you know what I mean? Whereas now you're in day one, off you go.
But quite often you can spend your first week and you have to kind of get to know how people work, what their strengths are, you know, who's the best person to ask for that, how is, does that dynamic in that relationship work? And if they're all fresh relationships, it's kind of sort of speed dial, isn't it, as to finding out how those different team relationships work. When I hear you talk, Gail, about how your career sort of been focused on producing and rep, and I think that's such an important training, learning ground for those, because it's different every day, isn't it? It's different. There's no staticness where you get into a routine, you're constantly thinking about who needs to know that, and we talk about those buzzwords of, you know, what makes a good stage manager, and everyone goes, teamwork, communication, and we hear it all the time. What is good communication? It's not just what you say, it's how you listen, or how you send that message, or type an email, isn't it? It's so multifaceted.
I used to do a whole class on body language, non-verbal communication. Which is why this world we're in now, this virtual world, is really challenging. The non-verbal communication, it's a huge part of a message. And if you don't have, even in Zoom, we're missing a lot of signals, subtle signals. The voice, we're missing a lot of subtle signals within the voice as well, especially on the phone, because there's a lot of frequencies missing in a phone conversation. So I think communication for me is about all the language around about the words. And it's so important that the listening, that you're actively listening, that your body is active in a communication. And there's nothing worse than trying to talk to somebody or say something to somebody if it's just blank, if there's nothing there, because that's a barrier. I think the other major thing really is the digitization of a lot of the processes. I mean, I think what we do is pretty much the same, don't you?
Definitely. I agree.
The process is exactly the same. It's just the tools we use to get from the read through to the opening night. The tools we use have changed, but the process is exactly the same.
The tools have just made working practice so... I think they've enhanced it. I'm not into technology for technology's sake, but I'm really into the things that have enhanced it. So being able to share documents, being able to work on a running list together. Oh, it's so exciting. I mean, I just genuinely think the tools are impressive, but you've got to control them rather than them control you.
Jackie, what sort of tools are your students favouring at the moment in terms of prompt copies, in terms of distribution of information?
Well, it is very digital, and that's, you know, we're trying to be best in our practice in sustainability. So for example, we were looking at a tour pack today, and instead of printing off these huge things, we looked at how we might organize them digitally and how a cast or creative team could access this information. But thinking about, we attended, and they're fantastic, and I find them so interesting, the Tech Friday Broadway Symposium technology.
Brilliant. Absolutely brilliant.
And they have highlight so many great ways that we can streamline our practice. But absolutely, Gail, as you said, it's not changing anything we do. So we're still doing the same things. It's just making it a little bit smoother and a little bit easier. I do talk a lot about technology in the rehearsal room. Sometimes it can become a barrier. That laptop between the DSM and mm-hmm. the cast is just another barrier. And it's about, if you talk about prompting, for example, and it's so intuitive for a DSM to know when to prompt, how to prompt, when, you know. And it's similar for, I think, a laptop in the rehearsal room, isn't it? If absolutely, use it, type up your rehearsal notes, if it's going to save you that hour at the end of the day, but knowing when to tap away and when not to, or when your attention is needed in the room, is a whole skill in itself.
Yeah, absolutely.
You may recall, ladies, on a previous podcast, because I know Gail has listened to all of them.
I have.
Jackie and Bruce Guthrie really were on a roll about how you should write things down and handwrite things down. Because I don't believe that at at all. I'm like, what are you two going on about? But I can see how directors think that they look over and they see stage managers on their laptop or on their iPhones or on an iPad, and they're like, oh, well, they're not paying attention, are they?
It's an issue of trust, I think, because if you're working with a director that knows really well, knows that you're super efficient and you are actually engaged, even though you're typing on your laptop, you are engaged, you're taking it all in, you're still working as efficiently, and that trust is there, then that's fine. But I think probably, Antonia, you know, you've been doing this a long, long, long time. And you also work with directors.
What's in that? Long, 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 long time.
But I've been in it long, 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 long time. You will be engaged. You will be listening with a 360 head on. So therefore, I think maybe it's potentially dangerous for students who are learning all these skills. And maybe they just need to take it a little step at a time and also help the directors win that trust through proof of efficiency and effectiveness.
I do appreciate that there has to be a happy medium, but I'm also on the other side aware that how technology is made is so available. If you're doing a tech session of 3 or 4 hours, whatever it may be, I'm in the room. Everyone who needs me right now is in this same room or at the end of the relay so they can get a hold of me. And then if not, they'll have to wait until I check my phone in 3 hours. I say that like I'm really disciplined. I'm probably not.
She's so lying. She's so lying.
But I like to think of myself, my alter ego me, who is, you know, the perfect version. Wouldn't check my phone.
Balance is about what suits you.
And, absolutely. You know, yep.
And the same whether you write things in a notebook or you write it on your computer. You know, it's about what suits you. And actually, I think that's one of the great things about stage management is, yes, the processes are the same, but the way in which we do them, we do have room. We do have flexibility. You can tackle things in different ways and find things that work better for you.
Do you find you manage to strike that work-life balance, or do you think it's difficult to do as a stage manager?
So I think when I the first 10 years, I think my whole life was theatre, and that was fine. I loved my life. I had the most wonderful time. Then I got a job in a rep in an area where I made friends outside of the theatre, which was an extraordinary experience for me. I met musicians and performers, and I did community theatre with them outside of my kind of professional job at the Bar Theatre. And then when I got into teaching, I guess I found a better balance, in as much as I allowed myself to have a weekend sometimes. I allowed myself to switch off occasionally. Whereas when I was in producing theatre, the show was your life. I mean, I just, you know, I thought about it all the time. Even though I was out maybe socialising with people who weren't in theatre, I was still emotionally engaged. I think I did, however, start to feel a bit uneasy when I found that patterns in my working life started, or unhelpful behaviours that seemed positive in my working life seemed to bleed into my personal life. And by that I mean, as stage management, we are trained, and I think it's just inherent in our natures, when we walk into a room, a rehearsal room, a stage, on stage, certainly for me, I'm just looking at risks. I'm looking at the company. I'm aware of who's not feeling very well in the room. I'm aware that's quite a high bit of staging, so need to check the barrier on that. So I go into kind of risk management mode. So every space I go into, that's my first, you know, I scan the room, the exits, the da-da-da. What became slightly worrying was that then happening in my personal life. I would walk into a room and, you know, or a gig. I'd be out seeing a show or at a gig, whatever. and I'd be going fire exits, and I would start scanning the audience to see if anybody looked a bit poorly, you know. So that I would sit at the end of a row in case there was an evacuation, and I could be the one kind of directing. And I'm, you know, so it really started affecting my enjoyment and my ability to just relax and let go. Let go of control, let go of having to be the responsible person in any given situation. And that I found really worrying. And I mean, I don't know if have either of you found the elements of your professional life have bled into in not a useful and potentially damaging way?
I absolutely hear what you're saying, and I can relate to bits of it in that I find it hard to let go of being in control outside of work. Well, I go through phases. You know, it can be a conversation at home where we're talking about what we're going to watch on telly, and I'll be like, I don't really care. Just pick something. I'm not deciding anything more today. That it just can't, haven't got that capacity. But then I also, you know, if something's not done in the way I would like to see it done, and I lose that element of control, then I'm not happy about it, you know. So, for example, it could be something domestic. And if, you know, if my husband's doing it, I should just be happy that it's being done and I haven't got to worry about it, and, you know. But I'll go, oh, but I
wouldn't. Is it being done right?
Exactly. It's not folded the way I would fold it, Gail. Yeah.
But if I was somewhere and there was a crisis situation, I know I would. I stopped doing my first aid years and years ago because I decided I didn't want to have that level of responsibility. And not long after I decided not to renew it, I was about three cars behind in a car crash. And I was like, no, I'm not a first aider. And there was a gentleman had gone over the bonnet of a car and he was just flat out in the middle of the road. And I heard people say, let's move him. And I was like, oh God, right. I can't bear it any longer. So of course I got out the car and I was like, no, do not move him. Has somebody? And you kind of, even though you try not to, you know, in the light of some other people doing what they thought was the best thing, trying to move him out of the line of traffic. However, you know, I was like, no, I think it's very hard. I think that's part of our nature, you know.
It's in our DNA. It's one of the reasons we ended up where we were, because our natural desire to make things right, to sort the problem over here with a couple of people, or to try and make that thing over there work, or that kind of problem solving, the smoothing troubled waters. And
people look to stage management to make the decision. You'll make the right decision. You know, I've definitely stopped a show for the right reasons. Sometimes you'll make the wrong decision. I've also definitely stopped a show when I didn't need to. But that's just in our nature. It's the decision-making thing, that ability to step up and make the call, I think is in our DNA.
It was a twofold thing. It was, one was a control thing, but the other was a heightened sense of awareness, a heightened sense of awareness of risk. And it became, it was really affecting my ability to just go out and enjoy myself. And it really was about risk management. So much so that at that point I thought, well, really, I've got to do something about this. So CBT was really, really useful. It's a recognised thing, apparently, with people in the sort of jobs that we're in. Again, This was many years ago, before kind of mental well-being was being discussed openly. So it was quite a hard thing to, I didn't go to the doctor, I heard about a counsellor. Because again, all those years ago, going to a counsellor, again, you didn't really say, I'm seeing a counsellor. So it's so good nowadays that we are able to talk openly on, you know, podcasts such as this and many others. So yes, CBT, cognitive behavioural therapy, just to realign my responses, because that was really what had got out of control, was my responses to situations, and that I just got into bad patterns of behaviour. Well, bad as in they were harming me. So I don't think they were harming anybody else, but they were harming me. So years of practicing different techniques, etc. I love going to gigs. Ironically, not been to anything this year. Well, no, that's not true. I saw the opening and closing show at Pitlochry Festival Theatre in the spring, Barefoot in the Park, and it was such a good production. But yes, it was the opening night and the closing night.
Very good.
That was the last show I saw.
Do you think the CBT has fed into your stage management practice as well to make you a better stage manager? Are you able to sort of step back and say, well, okay, you've got a different response, or a less immediate response?
I think it was very useful as a lecturer to recognise patterns in a rehearsal room, or recognize patterns during the show, and to maybe have a quiet word in an ear, or you know, it's not like giving advice, but it's just saying, if you tried doing it this way, so recognizing other people kind of struggling with things certainly helped with that. And again, it's about trust, isn't it? It's about trust in your team. You know, you're not the only person here. There's lots of other specialists who can deal with that particular crisis, is better practiced, better suited, has more experience with that particular problem. So, yes, it's putting more trust and responsibility into the team.
I think that's a really good point there, Gail, because our natural response is to take responsibility for everything. Yeah. But before we let Gail go, there's something else I wanted to talk about. You had a prototype of a DSM queuing system, but now that computer program has grown into a full-scale, proper ex-queuing support. So do you want to tell us about it?
And I will very, very briefly. So from those early days, I guess the reason that I started thinking about this whole project was the fear factor. I'm sure we all remember our first show at college, our first book at college, sitting there on a first night, not having much practice, maybe a bit of a tech and a dress if you're lucky, into a show, you've got audience out there. It is terrifying because you've never had enough practice on the prompt desk. You've pressing the buttons and saying go at the right time. And getting that to happen at the same time, go and the finger going on the go button at the same time. It's quite a tricky practical thing to master in the first place. Never enough practice. And then my first book at the Lyceum Theatre, my first professional book, again, not enough rehearsal. And I thought, there's 600 people out there. It was the first night, 600 people in the audience, at least 20 people backstage, all the actors waiting to go, and everybody waiting for me to say, House Lights and LX1, go. And I thought, I can't do this. Why are they asking me to do this? This is ridiculous. You know. Anywho, I got through that first night, but I'll never forget that total abject fear. So thinking back to that, and also then watching my students going through that same first night fear factor, I thought, oh, there must be something that can be produced. Anyway, long story short, we now have some software that's available, downloadable from the website, and then you get provided an activation code, which trains show callers in show calling. You watch a film of a show, you have your prompt copy, you have an overlay across the keys, the QWERTY keys, with a row of red standby lights and a row of green go lights, and you cue a show. The great thing about it is it stops you if you make a mistake. So if you make a mistake, a little window comes up, a text box, and it says, you're too late with LX5, go back to the previous sequence. So you can rehearse your calling and your button pressing, and make as many mistakes as you like in a safe environment. So CallQ Trainer is for students and CPD, and early career stage management, and it comes with three pre-configured shows. We've just released CallQ Studio, where you can import your own show and program it, cue it, program it, and then convert it into trainer and give it to either students if you're in a college environment, or for show cover. So on the big shows that aren't going to change a huge amount, you can record your own show and give it to the person who's on show cover to practice in a safe environment. So you can make mistakes and nobody's going to care. Nobody's going to fall over a truck that's moving too fast. Nobody's going to get knocked out by that piece of scenery coming in too early. It's a safe environment. So that's CallQ. And you can have a free trial on the website. It's CallQ with a Q, callq.uk.com. There we go. My memory served me reasonably well for that. It's doing really well. We've sold over about 600 licenses to colleges, universities, drama schools across the world. Again, the US have really taken it on board, and the UK are getting there. And obviously Sharjah as well, and Singapore and the Netherlands. And we've got a Spanish play we're about to add to our repertoire.
Ooh.
So for our Spanish speaking colleges and things, not that I understand every word of the script because I don't speak Spanish, but I have a translation. So yes, it's doing really quite well, and we're really pleased. And digital, you know, online training, obviously at this time, has been quite helpful.
And for me, it does exactly what it says on the tin and how you've just explained it, in that we are getting better. We are getting slightly better in training and in conservatoires and drama schools about making it a safe. We talk all the time about we're making it a safe environment. It's a safe space. You have safety nets. You can make mistakes. Mm-hmm. We say all that and then we check them on stage in the front or backstage and say, don't misplace the prop. Remember to call the cues. And we check all that pressure back on them. So it's such a beautiful way in order to make that a safe space for them to learn.
We hope you enjoyed this episode of Stand By Please. Join us next time when we'll be discussing allowing yourself that time to breathe.
Until next time, Jackie and Antonia of Cannes.